Good morning. Well, let's get started with this morning's first keynote speech. First, I would like to introduce Dr. Yang and myself. Dr. Yang is from Kaohsiung Med University, and I from Shanghai Zhaohong University. Now, first, we have three speakers in this session, and the first speaker is Dr. Beate Ritz. Dr. Ritz already presented something yesterday, and today I'll just very briefly introduce her, the academic credentials. Dr. Ritz is a professor of epidemiology at the UCLA School of Public Health. Her main interest is in environmental occupational toxins and on reproductive perinatal outcomes and neurodegenerative disorders. She has been UCLA since 1993. So today, her talk is about 2 decades of research on air pollution and reproductive outcomes. Thank you.
So this picture actually has the main features of what air pollution looks like in LA. Here you can see our high-rises downtown in the typical smog. So the sky should be looking like this up here, which is a little more blue, like what we see today outside. But when you look towards the downtown area, you see this brown haze. And that's what LA is famous for, it's smog. So it's fog and smoke together, that's what the name is. And if this wasn't there, you would actually see mountains, beautiful mountains in the back. But we don't see them during days like this. But nowadays, we actually can see them quite a lot. So we cleaned this up. This was about 20 years ago, a typical picture. That's another one, a little later, taken later, and you can see there's a rim of a mountain up there. It's in a different direction, but you can see it now. And this is the other contribution to air pollution. So this one is the typical smog from exhaust and cars, mostly. What you see here is actually the sunrise after a wildfire, and I was actually evacuated, and I took this from place where I was staying that night. Not bad as a palm tree, but these aren't clouds. This is actual smoke from the wildfires in San Diego. And this is the sunrise that looks really beautiful, and the sunset is even more beautiful. But it's definitely not an air quality you want to breathe. So, and these kind of wildfires, of course, and that's why I have this picture here, reminds us that climate change in California, even so we probably cleaned up this quite a bit, wildfires are really a problem in terms of the future for California and the air quality of California. Oops. So, we also have probably seen this picture before, but I just wanted to point out ambient air particulate matter, and this is just particulate matter. We're not talking about ozone, and part of that smog we just saw was actually ozone, right? But particulate matter is in the top 10 in 2012 of all the risk factors, the dailies of the attributable leading risk factors in the world. But when you look at this bar and you then can decipher what diseases we attribute to the risk factor particulate matter, is acute and chronic respiratory diseases, cardiovascular diseases, and cancers. Well, I'm here to talk about reproductive outcomes, right? They're nowhere on there. So we have air pollution being among the top 10 when we completely ignore reproductive outcomes. They are not even considered in the burden of disease, which I actually consider a personal failure of my research. It still hasn't made in 1990, but the picture has changed a little bit, but I wanted to point out already in 1990, MA particulate matter was among the top five, and it hasn't improved. If anything, it has gotten worse. Again, none of the diseases that I will talk about, neonatal disorders, are even included in this estimate. So, where did we, why is that the case? Well, the 2015 meta-analysis of particulate matter 2.5, which we now consider as probably most relevant for health effects, if not ultra fines, you can see that most of these estimates suggest that there is a relationship with birth weight, low birth weight, preterm birth, small for gestational age, and on average there's a 5 to 15% increase in risk per 10 microgram increase in PM2.5. And, you know, this is just one of the many meta-analyses that you can find out in the literature. So, but let me go back and tell you where this all started, the research on air pollution. It started in LA. So, when I was a junior faculty in 1993, for some reason I came across this very early paper by colleagues from anthropology. So this wasn't done by environmental health scientists. This was actually a group of women in anthropology saying, well, we have a problem. It was published in 1977. We have a problem in LA with air. Why don't we look at it? And they were very brave. They just used this old map of LA and then carved it up into sectors and of air pollution, air quality. And in the 1970s, there were a few monitors, but not very many. So EPA had just started putting out a few. It was, 72 was the Clean Air Act, so this was right in that time frame. And the records they got from a hospital were in 1973, and according to these records, they carved out this, this map in this way. They selected only women who were non-smokers, and then looked at their average birth weight of the babies according to in what sector they lived after having rated these sectors according to the quality of the air. And they found that on average, these kids that were born to women in the worst air quality sectors in LA had 314 grams less in birth weight, their babies had 314 grams less. You know that this is about 10% of a baby's birth weight, right? That's a lot. Not only is it 10% of a baby's birth weight, this is as much as you would reduce birth weight if a woman was smoking 2 packs of cigarettes throughout pregnancy. Okay? So this is how the air was in LA in the 1970s. And we weren't very proud of it. What amazed me a lot more was when I found this paper, nobody had done anything afterwards. So in the mid-90s, I came across a paper that was almost 20 years old and nobody had followed up on it anywhere. The only other paper I could find on birth outcomes was from the Czech Republic, and having a German background, I knew how the air was there, comparable to LA, if not worse. So I thought, well, we should be doing studies in LA, and this is one of the first ones that I published on the effect of carbon monoxide on low birth weight in LA. You can see that was 1999. I just told you I started being interested in this in the mid-1990s, so why did it take me this long? Well, one reason was that the computers at the time weren't fast enough to crunch the numbers, right? You might not remember that because now you have, you know, pretty much a supercomputer on your desk. When I did this research, my computer ran 2 years to generate exposure estimates. Yes, and that was a high-end one. So that said, but that wasn't the worst that hindered me. I needed a little bit of funding to actually buy records, birth records, and get some other things done. And in order to get that money, you have to write grants. Well, my first grant review came back saying, Dr. Ritz is an MD and doesn't know that babies built in the womb don't breathe. They don't breathe air. Okay, honestly, I can show you that was one comment I got. And it was because at the time what people did was look at adults, look at mortality, look at respiratory outcomes, and just starting to look at cardiovascular disease, right? And even the cardiovascular disease field was considered strange because, you know, how does a particle or whatever get to the heart when, you know, really the organ of entry is just the lung? Lung, everybody could understand. And definitely go first way, you know, there's all that filtering going on. There's the placenta. The placenta should have taken care of this. Well, it obviously didn't. So, that said, I wasn't discouraged. I got a little bit of money. I did this research, and I started having these papers come out. And when these papers came out, I got questions. And one of the questions was, well, how do you really know that this is air pollution and not smoking, being poor, you know, all the things that you have in LA that also might cause low birth weight. And you know, we have a very diverse population, so you can imagine all the risk factors. It took me another few years to get funding from NIEHS for this small study in which we interviewed about 2,600 women randomly selected from all births in 2003. And I spent all my money going after what I wasn't interested in, which were the confounding factors. But it was extremely important to do. So we used my exposure assessment model, which was pretty much the ambient air measured at the ambient stations. And then we asked the women about indoor air source pollutions in transit, exposures, as well as smoking, alcohol, diet, occupation, psychosocial stress, time activity, anything you could think of that might have been influencing these birth outcomes. And I ended up doing some fancy statistics with two-stage designs as well, and accounting for selection bias, which at the time was really on vogue. And after all of that, I found that the estimates, this was from the birth cohort that was confounded, supposedly, showing me a 10% increase at the highest level of first trimester PM2.5. In the women from the survey after adjustment, what happened is the effect estimate increased. It was a 30% increase in risk. And the mid-level exposures also had possibly some effect, although the confidence intervals were wide. So I thought, well, I had solved that problem, right? And now people would believe me, there's no confounding. Well, they didn't believe me, but luckily I came to ISEE, I made my little speeches, told people what I've seen, and since birth records in Europe and other places are easy to obtain, people actually started now looking at it. And this is a beautiful paper, old paper from 2013, that uses the ESCAPE data, which is a wonderful exposure assessment tool that Bert, our former president, developed and got lots of people to collaborate with, and then Marie Peterson used all of these child cohorts, and here they are listed, to look at these birth outcomes in a very comprehensive way. And the beauty of these data sets is she already had all the confounding variables. So she could fully adjust for all of the factors that I had gone after as well. And when she did that, look at this. Doesn't look so different, right? An about 20% increase in low birth weight due to air pollution in the ESCAPE study, adjusted for everything she could think of and the European birth cohorts give you. And she also was able to then look at PM absorbance, NO2, traffic density, and you can see the estimates vary, but there's always something going on. Maybe not for the larger particles, but definitely traffic density. So, nevertheless, we still didn't have this outcome in the burden. And throughout the 2000-2010 times, we got into building better models, building better exposure models. Because what I had started with, the first data that I showed you, came from this kind of model. So this is LA, and this is a map of LA with the EPA stations, and this is a 2-mile area around the EPA monitoring station. And when I thought about exposure misclassification, and we heard that, you know, the bane of environmental epidemiology is exposure measurement, I knew that. So I wanted to be as close to a station as possible to have as little exposure misclassification as possible. And so I only selected women who live in zip codes close to the station. Everybody criticized me for this because I left all these other women out, and you know, but I still had 125,000 births around these stations. It's a dense area over 5 years. So nowadays, we can improve this exposure assessment a lot, and we can have something that looks like this, which is a Krieging map that we generated in 2017. It's also from 1993, so instead of this Swiss cheese, we now have a nice map, right? And I will show you the results when we use that. However, what I also knew, and colleagues of mine at UCLA had shown, was that really the pollution sources in LA were cars. And this is a roadway, and these are the carbon monoxide or ultrafine particle patterns from the source. And you can see here that particle number, black carbon and carbon monoxide, are highest in the middle of the road. This is the 405 freeway, the most used freeway in the world, I've been told. And then when you go in downwind from it at about 200 meter distance, 150 to 200 meters, you're at background level again. So you have a real peak exposure very close to those roadways. Well, if we have this peak exposure and I just apply the background, aren't I again doing a lot of things that cause exposure misclassification? Well, I probably do. So this is the roadways and, you know, how many cars we have on them. The black line are more than 100,000, so you can see there's a lot of those. And this is what I then spent a year or two building with my colleague, Dr. Jarrett. It's called the Land Use Regression Model, and you can see that it pretty much reflects, it has that nice smooth element to it that the Krieging map did, but it also has the road pattern, because it now predicts a lot more exposure closer to the roadways. So this California Air Resource Board paid for this, and we can now predict air pollution at a much finer scale. And we use this model. My colleague at UC Irvine also used an EPA model, the Caline 4. That's a dispersion model that's based on emissions on the roadways, but it only goes to up to 500 to 1,000 meters from the roadway and pretty much ignores the background. So it's mostly based on the acute emissions in the vicinity of the source. Well, we have all these beautiful measures, and when we now compare across the maps across LA, this would be the Krieging map, this would be the land use regression map, where we have traffic and land use coming together to predict exposure, traffic is included, and this is just based on the source traffic with emissions, okay? And you can see that we are seeing different types of exposure patterns, and we can now apply those to my data in Los Angeles, and this is what we see. So if we use NOx from Krieging, the adjusted odds ratio here for this preterm burst is 13% increase in risk. When I use the LUR model, we get in about 5%, 5 to 7% increase in risk. If we use the Caline dispersion model based on emissions, we get about 4% increase in risk. If I had only used traffic density, I would have gotten in about 2% increase in risk. So in the end, the simple model based on the EPA monitors years would have given me what I needed, but I had to convince myself that, you know, I couldn't be doing better. And yes, you can do better with some of these models, maybe, but for these first outcomes, it pretty much doesn't matter. All that matters is there's an increase in risk. All right. So these are all the criteria pollutants, the particles, the NOs that come out of trucks. What about air toxics? Because maybe this is just really based on toxic air pollutants. One of them, of course, is benzene. Yeah, all the traffic-related ones. And we have toxic air toxic monitoring stations, four of them in LA that have been operating since the year 1990. And you can see, yes, I also see a signal for, in this case, low burst weight of about a 4% increase for benzene and a little bit less for some of the others. So the story is basically the same. And then we have something called source apportionment that we heard about yesterday, right? So now we can use chemical mass balance models and source apportionment to get to source apportionment. We had seven monitoring stations in LA like this, and we restricted to women, in this case, who lived within 5 miles of these stations. And for PM organic, we have an about 13% increase in risk, and for the elemental carbon, 12%, ammonium nitrate, 21, 13, 12. Pretty much it tells you it doesn't matter what the PM2.5 is, it all harmed the baby. I thought I could improve. Maybe I could say it's really diesel that we have to get rid of and not the biomass. No, biomass is bad, diesel is bad. So I couldn't find the actual source. I guess we have to do something about all of them. All right, but I tried. So this is another picture where we just looked at gasoline, same picture. So I showed all of this in LA, right? And LA is great because we have all these tools and we have beautiful data, but what else should we be doing? Should we be doing more traditional epi on pregnancy outcomes somewhere else? I already told you the Europeans did a lot. And there are a few studies in other places, Brazil is one of them. But should we be doing something in Africa, in Asia, in South America? And what would be the problem or not of doing this? Well, the main problem is that we would need an exposure model, right? And unfortunately, some of the places that have the worst air pollution don't have good ambient exposure assessment, ground level exposure assessment. And this is where this project MAIA comes in that I'm part of now. It's MAIA stands for multi-angle imaging of aerosols, and it is a new satellite-based project where a camera is going to be flown on a satellite starting in 2020. It's a JPL, Jet Propulsion Lab project paid by NASA. And we will have a camera that will have multiple views, probably 5 views, of the same area and imaging polarized light, and therefore not only being able to tell you what the particle mass is within 1 kilometer. So far, MISR is only 4 kilometer maximum, but it also will tell you what the composition of the particles is. So we can now do this worldwide, and I hope that we can do it in many, many different places. These are some of the targets that we have chosen in the first round of this flight to look at outcomes. And worse outcomes, I'm glad to say, will be one of them. So there's hope that we can do this in other places, and I think it's really important because whatever we see in LA may or may not be true in other areas, just because, not because the biology is different, but the politics are different, right? So we can argue again and again, we see this in Europe and in LA, but local governments want to see data from their own districts. So one thing to do is definitely do these studies in some more places. Another thing to do would be to now investigate biologic pathways. And I believe that part of why we haven't Yes, it's because animal placentas are really different from human placentas. And human placenta and human pregnancy is kind of unique. I've been told that sheep are usually used as the best model, but they don't fit easily in cages. And you know, it's not like rodent models. They are much more expensive. So we unfortunately don't have great animal models for this. But we have humans, and we can look at biology in humans, and these are some of the studies that have come out that try to do this. For example, look at hypertensive complications and gestational pro-hypertensive effects, blood pressure in the mother, and preeclampsia. So this is trying to get away from just measuring weight in the baby, measuring preterm births, to some of the biological causes for the preterm births, because we know that hypertension in pregnancy is part of preeclampsia, and preeclampsia is the main cause for induced preterm births, right? And saying that preeclampsia, we actually showed for the LA area, really does, the risk of preeclampsia does increase with NOx and PM2.5 in almost the dose response pattern. So clearly these outcomes are affected by air pollution. And we also have now a few studies showing, one by Peyton Lee, who's from Taiwan, that we have inflammatory reactions, something we all suspected that air pollution does, in the mother during pregnancy, that probably has a relationship with both preterm birth and low birth weight. And we also might even see this in animals, and this is one of the few animal studies, in this case in rabbits, where they dose the rabbits with diesel engine exhaust and now actually look at placenta function, and it was the intent to look at intergenerational effects. So this is very exciting. And that's what I actually think we need to do, which is in humans, look at placenta function. These are the only studies I found so far that try to look at at air pollution and some kind of biologic pathway in placentas. And most of these, they have different names, but most of these come out of Tim Navrat's lab. So this is a group that has been very, very active now, trying to go after the biology in humans of air pollution, and it's really important. And I'm glad they're doing this. And at UCLA, we were lucky enough to get funding now after 20 years of doing the EPI studies in the Human Placenta Project, and there are 8 of them funded by NIH, and we are one, and we're the only one looking at really environmental exposures, in this case, air pollution. And so what we are doing here is we are scanning the placenta with MRIs twice in pregnancy to assess blood flow. The hope is that we can get more to the biology of the placenta while the placenta is intact, but we will also capture the placentas and then do pathology on them and methylation on them after the baby is born. So this is very exciting. And my job is to hang these air monitors in the women's homes. They're very, very tiny, and they can be installed now. And that's also technology has gone on and given us these beautiful instruments now. We can actually hang them indoors and outdoors in the women's homes. They're called the purple air particle monitors. And we can leave them there for 6 months or longer. They just keep continuously monitoring, and we can download it from the web. And they have nano-to-fine scale measures continuously that we then can relate to anything we pick up during our observation of the mother during pregnancy. The other really exciting part of new technology is metabolomics. And again, in California, this is a big advantage that the state is so active in collecting samples from the prenatal screening program in the 16th week of pregnancy, where women are screened for birth defects, and the leftover serum is of a lot of the moms in California, not all of them, but a lot of them, is county dependent, is kept in freezers. So we can now go back to these freezers and pull out controls or cases, several samples from the 16th week and do metabolomics analyses. And we have done that, for example, for air pollution. And then with a lot of systems biology, we can pick out pathways that are affected by the exposure. And the first paper is coming out soon on this. And I'm very excited about this. So, what is underexplored? Well, we probably have exposure measurement issues left to solve, but I honestly think that we are doing pretty well with this exposure assessment. For pregnancy, we need to get the timing right. We need to know better which trimester is more important than others. But and also whether the first year of life for later events is important. We can't get around the complex mixture problem. Particles are always a mixture. But I told you, no matter what the source was, the particle wasn't good for the mother. So maybe it's not such a problem that we consider it a mixture. We still need to go after the biologic mechanisms. They are largely unknown. And for that, we have to integrate toxicology, pathology, and clinical outcomes in humans. I told you I did all the epidemiology I could and couldn't convince the global burden. So now I'm thinking maybe with this we can. And I'm hopeful that we do. Nevertheless, this problem will not go away. These are women in Beijing. Wearing masks, trying to protect themselves against air pollution. And this was the news from Nature News in 2013. Air pollution delivers smaller babies. And this is my last slide from the Department of Crazy Ideas. So here is my LA driver in the 1979 where we started, right? And she cannot live without her cover LA, but she still wants to protect herself. Luckily, we now cleaned the air up for her quite a bit, and I can assure you we did. And this is the latest crazy idea, a Chinese millionaire trying to sell cancer fresh air. I don't think that's the way to go, but it's certainly a way to make money. And I want to thank my my funders and my colleagues. None of this was done just by me. And Paige Lee's not even on here. But she should be. So